Virin had grown accustomed to the muted, prolonged ailments that accompanied the approach of old age, but he felt the aches and pains more acutely in summer than in any other season. They ripened and gathered strength by late August, the anniversary of his defection, tormenting his joints, vessels, and eyeballs, only to vanish with ease in early fall, when the heat abated and the barometer calmed down. "Maybe this was the death sentence given me in absentia," he joked to himself, his lips tasting the wormwood of death postponed. "Or is my body taking its revenge?" he thought. "Revenge for the new face created by the plastic surgeon. The scars and birthmarks lasered away. Does it remember and prepare its revenge on the anniversary of my defection?" He had persistent conjunctivitis from the contact lenses that altered his eye colour. His legs ached from the lifts in his shoes. His hair was brittle from the dye. Being someone else entailed intensive daily labour. He couldn't get used to it. Formerly, the previous person no longer existed. There was another one now, a foundling, a changeling, with a biography created by masters of lies and transformations. A different language, different habits, even his dreams were different. A different memory that seemed to have subsumed the old one. The new identity fit him like a prosthetic device. Seldom did it feel like a natural part of him. His body, redrawn by a scalpel, remembered the visceral memory of guts, liver, and kidneys, where the byproducts of existence settle and crystallize, like gallstones and kidney stones. It resisted, even though there was no returning to the past for Virin. The banal and metaphorical sentence had a direct juridical force as well. He learned not to suppress, but to value and observe sympathetically the stubbornness of aging flesh, denying the fake imposed sacrament of second birth. "Body, you are the only thing I have left," he would sometimes say with a strange adolescent tenderness. His body truly was the only material evidence that he had once been someone else. There was other evidence which he could not access or control. A paper ghost, a spare duplicate of his life, an archival eye that ordinary people did not possess, an officer's personnel file, the extract and essence of his previous self, not yet a defector, not yet a traitor. A light blue cardboard file, 225 by 330 by 25 millimeters. Even those dimensions are secret. Photo ID, file, autobiography, employment report, non-disclosure agreement, special profiling, endurance test, 3 kilometer cross-country run, character assessments, documents, documents, documents. He knew that after his defection, an order was promulgated, labelled top secret with 2 zeros as the number of the case document, and headed on measures in connection with A.V. Virin's treason. He had heard such orders read out in the secretariat about other men, all the same, as if written on carbon paper. Ideological transformation, moral collapse. Take measures to localize the consequences of treason. Only the names of the people to be punished were changed. Personnel officers, heads of education departments, heads of sub-departments, who had not shown adequate diligence and had not recognized a potential traitor in time. But he knew that in his case, the public reprimands were for naught. He had served the system with more loyalty than the others, and he was more frightened than the others when the country began falling apart, and it looked as if the system would collapse with it. Virin told himself that almost 3 decades had now passed, and the information he had revealed, the agents he had disclosed, were no longer important. The agents would have been burned anyway. Someone else would have given them away, if not I. I managed to sell them in time, like currency that would soon drop in value catastrophically. Another year or two, and who would need, say, information on agents among anti-Soviet émigrés or in the ranks of European communist parties, if the USSR itself no longer existed?